friends. I'd like to apologize for starting earlier than the schedule. This is my review time, since we're dealing with my review culture. So it's not a surprise, I would say. So I'm really pleased and greatly honored to moderate this session and to be part of this interesting, I would say, conference and debate concerning things perhaps we started to forget. The challenges of modernity, because modernity, of course, as we saw yesterday, is a complex concept, and we started to, I would say, take it for granted that we are modern, but we are not actually. You see that it's something really very, very challenging. Today, we will listen to four speakers, and I will give the floor according to the order in the schedule. So we'll first listen to Dr. Mohamed Yeshouti and Dr. Bishop Mohamed from the University of Mosul, and Dr. Yeshouti from the University of Ismail School of Arts, Meknes. And I just would like to say a word concerning my colleague, Dr. Yeshouti, who graduated from Fez University, and whose publications are varied and, I would say, tantalizing, because they're dealing with current issues like Syrian refugees in Morocco, realities and prospects, women of February the 20th movements in Morocco, and new feminist consciousness, and many other publications. Maybe the last one, which seems really very interesting to me, regularizing the status of irregular migrants in Morocco, program design and policy benefits. I think that this is now an issue that is facing not only Morocco, but I would say the world, concerning this notion of illegal, irregular migrants, etc. So, without much ado, then I will give the floor to Dr. Yeshouti. Thank you. I would just like to remind the speakers that I will be strict on the time allotted to each speaker. Thank you.
Okay, good morning, everyone. Thank you, Professor Mbaki. Thank you for being with us. It's a pleasure to be in your panel. I actually only I also apologize for, on behalf of my friend, Dr. Shep, who is not with us here today for certain reasons. Anyway, so before starting my talk, I just want to make a confession. In my life, I'm one of the most inactive citizens. I know. I hate confrontations and conflicts. Still, I'm always inspired and captivated by stories of people who have behaved different from me, regardless of their age, gender background, or religious background as well. Here today, I'm here today to talk about some of these stories and explain the significant considerations for political change in Morocco. So, as I say, the purpose of my paper is to investigate the nature of the form and forms of civil resistance in Morocco after the post Arab Spring in Morocco and their impact on political change. So my paper or my talk starts from the assumption that though 2011 constitutional reforms have been very revolutionary in terms of content, but they have not really contributed or resulted in very significant changes in terms of democracy, but which actually resulted in the emergence of a new subaltern forms of resistance that are different from any previous forms of resistance. So to do this, I use a kind of comparative approach. I compare forms of resistance before this period of the Arab Spring in Morocco and after. I will focus mainly, and the focus of course is on the post-Moroccan Spring movement. So I did this based on my research, which I conducted from 2006 2012, and I'm following this new form of resistance between 2011 and 2017 or 18. So by following these new forms on the ground and through media. Okay, so in my talk, I divided into four parts. The first one is just explaining the three keywords in my presentation, which are civil resistance, public sphere, and political change, and see what and explain what I mean by these two terms in or three terms in my presentation. Second one, traces the development of civil resistance in Morocco, starting from the pre-colonial era. And the fourth section will focus on the reform or the outcomes of the Arab Spring in Morocco, especially the constitutional reforms. And then I will also go on sitting some of these forms of subaltern resistance in Morocco, and I will focus mainly on those which receive a lot of media attention and which have a lot of echo in the public sphere. And before closing, backwards, finish reflecting on these new forms of resistance in Morocco. So, civil resistance may be defined as an act of public protest whose objectives are directed toward a law or a policy of the government or toward a corporate entity whose policy is subject to the protest. The hope of the civil actionist or resistors or activists is to make a dramatic appeal to the conscience of the community, affect public awareness, and motivate citizens to demand change in certain policies. They also, I mean, the civil activists, they endorse the principle that citizens have responsibility to resist elderly government aggression, wrongdoing, corruption, and act out to prevent more of the government's injustices. Civil resistance take different forms and involve the groups use tactics that are beyond the traditional conventional political practices such as voting and lobbying, but they employ other forms such as strikes, protests, and sit-ins to influence change. However, in this paper, the main forms of civil resistance which I focus on, they go beyond these forms of resistance to include new ones. And the focus is made on these self-immolations and protest suicides that have taken place mainly after 2011 in Morocco. For any civil resistance to take place, the public sphere must be guaranteed as a freedom for freedom from the state and by the state itself. So the concept of the public sphere owes much of its public academic popularity to the German philosopher Jürgen Habermas and his publication, The Structural Transformation of the Public Sphere. In this book, or for Habermas, public sphere is made up of private individuals gathered together as a public and articulating the needs of a society within the state. It's also the medium through which horizontal, among citizens, and vertical between civil societies or citizens and the state, communication becomes possible. And through which communicative power, by communicative power we mean the demands and claims of citizens, can translate into the administrative power, and the administrative power mean the laws reformed by the state or the government, providing the state with the legitimacy on which to base its public policies. So the objective, as I told you, the aim is to see whether the reappropriation of the public sphere in the aftermath of the Moroccan Spring and the spread of new subaltern forms of civil resistance, I mean, self-immolations and suicide and protest suicides have led to any real political change in the post-Moroccan spring. And by political change, I mean political outcomes that may result from any form of activism or civil resistance and which target change in and which target change in state policies and politics with long-term implications for the state's political system and culture. So, civil resistance in Morocco started with the establishment of the Moroccan state in the 16th century and have ever since taken different, come from different actors, namely from the ulama, the tribes, towns, and has taken different forms. Sometimes it has been, peaceful, and other, in most of the times it was very quiet. So, this political scientist in Hawaii University argues it's the civil resistance on the part of the of different social and political forces which have been important factors in shaping and reshaping the of the political system of the 20th century. So, as I told you, civil resistance dates back to the pre-colonial era. So it came mainly from the ulama, and in addition to the religious role, so these ulama stood as a resisting and disposing power to the rule to the sultan in times of his unjust ruling. There has also been continuous unrest of the country because of the tribal nature of this of the Moroccan society. This unrest is due mainly to the resistance and the refusal to pay taxes. In the pre-colonial era, Morocco was always, as you know, was always divided between Blood Siba and Blood Khizr. Blood Siba is the blood which were not, or the tribes which did not pay taxes, and Blood Khizr is the which obeyed the tribes which obeyed the ruling of or the government of the sultan. But that doesn't mean, for example, this. That Siba did not obey. They accepted the spiritual ruling of the sultan, but they refused to pay taxes. Okay. During the French protectorate to Morocco, resistance to colonial in both rural and areas was immense and took the form of the nationalist movement, which reacted to colonial intrusion in its economic, political, and cultural dimension. Also, the role of the ulama was also very significant. I mean, though they were alienated by the French authorities, the ulama turned to the conservative Islam to liberate the country in general and the sultan imported from foreign influence. Immediately after independence, cities such as Tessim and Nador in the north of Morocco saw various forms of resistance that were typical of the colonization era and of the challenges that faced the newly emerging state. In the early 1970s, also the civil resistance came from independent groups such as the Marxist-Leninist movement. However, these movements they were brought under tight state control, either through transforming them into a state institution or just repressing them. So this period was, as you know, was known as the years of league. Starting from the 90s, the early 80s and the beginning of the 90s, the state allowed the emergence of new groups, civil society groups, that act subsequently as forces of resistance in the following years. Okay, so these actors and groups have worked in the form of interest groups, forming this movement concerned with issues of human, women, and cultural rights. For the ulama, after the independence, their role has been undermined or confined through the use of religious institutions like Conseil de l'Ulama and the surveillance of the Sawayas, tombs of Muslim saints, and spaces for the practice of the Sufi Islam. The Arab Spring was a really turning point in the civil resistance movement in Morocco. But I'm not going to reiterate the story of the 20 February movement, but I will focus mainly on what happened, or what are the outcomes of this, the resistance of this movement. So So thanks to the resistance of the 24 movement, we have a very advanced institution now. So in the constitution, unlike the previous constitution, in the new constitution, the king is no longer sacred, but the integrity of this person is inviolable. The judiciary system is independent from the legislative and executive branch. The king guarantees this independence. Women are granted civic, social, and social equality with men. Previously, only citizens with equality in terms of rights. Though the 1996 constitution granted only citizen equality in terms of rights before the law, all citizens have the freedom of thought, ideas, artistic expression, and creation. In previous constitution, only free speech and freedom of circulation and association were guaranteed. Article 1, paragraph 2, insists that on principle of good governance of the correlation between responsibility for and the revenue of the account. And Article 27 stresses the right of all citizens to access information held by public administration, elected institution, and public service. So my argument, or our argument, me and Dr. Scherer, is that though these unconstitutional reforms have been very revolutionary in terms of content, that they have not pushed for real democratic value. For example, we still have the institution of the monarchy governing economic and religious power, still takes major decisions that concern the nation, both nationally and internationally, and still effectively controls the legislative, judiciary, and security forces. The ex-head of the government at that time, remember, repeatedly acknowledged that the role of his government is to implement the royal instruction or the instructions of the monarchy. The state official process of 2011 of restructuring and radically changing the socioeconomic and political condition of the citizens have gone with the wind. The only gain of the 24 movement for me is the psychological therapy it has provided all fractions of the Moroccan citizens. I mean, to get rid of the year of the, I mean, to get rid of the years, the field, the years of league that haunted them for years, and re-engage them in their battle for more rights and equality. So that's why, so one incarnation of this change is the emergence of these new subaltern forms of resistance, namely self-immolations and suicide protests, and other self-sacrifice. So for me, these subaltern resistance have gone beyond the traditional forms of activism to express a new culture of resistance in the media. So this culture is ideology free, distrusts political parties, unions, and civil society groups, celebrate the individual as the main actor in the process of civil resistance, and even sometimes delegitimizes the 24-year movement for not being able to achieve all its political objectives. So this makes these forms of civil subaltern forms of resistance different from any previous of resistance in throughout Moroccan history. So for the sake of this paper, or this talk, I have chosen five examples of these of the stories of those subaltern resistance, each of which exemplify the story of corruption and increasing disparity between the poor and the rich, and a strong sense of hunger and social injustice that Morocco has been unable to solve so far. So the choice is based, as I told you in the very beginning, based on the media attention they receive and also on the echo they have in the public sphere. So the first one is case number one is single mother versus herself in protest. So in February 2011, Amir Dhar Spring, who was 25 years old, set herself in fire in front of the town hall in central Morocco after being excluded from a social housing scheme because she was an unmarried mother. Criteria of eligibility set by local authorities don't consider divorced single women and single mothers as heads of the household as they live with that part. On the day Larry set herself on fire, she visited a local official one final time after having registered 6 complaints, none of which was taken into consideration. Added to this, And we have discovered that, part of the land is of the low income. Households would go directly to the businessman with, connections automatically. And we found a kind of temporary humiliation, especially that her family makeshift house had already been destroyed and she and her family had nowhere to go. So when in flames, that we lastly, as recorded on our mobile phone, is to take stand against injustice, corruption, and tyranny. Second one, you all, sir, I think you also remember the story, it's Amina Tlali. So in 2000, it's 1 year after, in March 2012, Amina Tlali, a 16-year-old child, hid herself in the outskirts of Larache, of the north of Morocco, by taking rat poison after she was forced to marry her rapist, who used to beat and torture her. After 6 months in this horrifying marriage, Amina put an end to her life as she saw no bright future in the horizon. Her death provoked several demonstrations to demand the repeal of Article 475 on the Moroccan Penal Code, which say that a man who rapes a minor can escape punishment if he marries the victim. The third case is the Mifatiha, the case seller. In April 2016, a 60-year-old street vendor named Mifatiha Salil Bhair, Moroccan Pente, committed self-immolation in Petra after Qaid district confiscated her stuff because she refused to move. After she, after she refused his order to leave the place, Qaid violently shook her, threatening her in front of the hall. Mifatiha built Tegra and therefore decided to set herself on fire in front of the Qaid district building, in front of the Qaid assistants who just ignored the incident. The third case is the case of the man rushed to death in a garbage truck. In October 2016, after confiscating and destroying his swordfish on the ground that is not permitted to catch swordfish at that time of the year, the fisherman Mohsin Pipi from Imzor, Mikasima City, just jumped into a garbage truck to retrieve his 500 kilograms of fish, but unfortunately, he was crushed to death by the truck's compactor. The famous verbal assault is remembered Hammo sandwiched his body instantly in the garbage truck. In less than 48 hours, the protests were taking place throughout Morocco, denouncing Pipi's horrible death and have been going since then. Last one, in this concerning this talk, it's the case of Meisha suicide jump. So in April 2017, an elderly woman named Meisha attempted to commit suicide by climbing up an electricity pole in Rabat next to the valley. So the old woman who lives in Sidi Taibi was able to climb the pole with a national flag to protest the humiliation that she experienced after her hand, after her land was seized. While on the top of the electricity, the old woman threatening to jump was heard to cry, "Long live the king, Hashem Ali, live long Muhammad V, I want my rights, I want my own property back." She said that a piece of land in her ownership was sold by fraud, B.R.D. Abdi Al-Adai. Staying on the pole for 2 hours, unfortunately, the woman eventually claimed after being compromised of immediate success. So based on this, so a thorough reanalysis of these, of the sabotage forms of the resistance, showed they have distinguishing characteristics that make them different from any other forms of struggle and resistance in the history of the history of Morocco. So first, these new forms of resistance are the product of the 20 February movement. I mean, if the 20 February movement has left any legacy, Israel has resulted in a radical shift between the relationship between the government and the government. In other words, the 20 February movement helped the citizens get rid of the fear of years of leave that helped them for decades and re-engaged them in their battle for more rights and equality. Another legacy of 2021 is that it has not only allowed the citizens to reappropriate the street and the public space, but has also given a voice to the marginalized groups and made the weak able to revolt and resist Haggar's humiliation and demand the execution of change and reforms. Second, they are here to fight Haggar and corruption. Because 2011 reforms did not lead to any democratic changes, the new subaltern forms of resistance have emerged to sacrifice itself for the sake of ousting the corruption. I have a note here. Moroccan's aspiration is not to dispose the king or seek absolute revolution, but rather to implement constitutional democratic reforms that would ensure more transparency and less corruption in the government. A very good example could be here. If you still remember the hectic days of the 20 February movement, the slogan raised is down with corruption, it's not down with the king. Second thing, unlike the previous forms of civil resistance, the new forms of civil resistance are not necessarily the product or the result of a coherent and a comprehensible ideology, but they are the result of the widespread feeling of Haggar. They are the result of the emergence of deep inequalities, social inequalities. They are the result of the growth of corruption. They are the result of the shortage in social and health services. And they are also the result of the contempt of people that is frequently shown by local government authorities in various social, political, and administrative institutions. Because this is what is important for me, is this reading of what happened exactly. So third, these subaltern forms of resistance are spontaneous and voluntary. So unlike the previous forms of resistance which were organized as and remained rooted in certain issues like human and women's rights, so these forms of self-sacrifice are spontaneous and voluntary, and the individual has become a player who maintains a central importance within the collective action. Citizens spontaneously sacrifice themselves to stand as guardians of the constitutional principles, democratic principles, and accountability. Another thing is that these new subaltern forms of resistance, they all come from the margins carried out by the poor of different age and gender groups and target dismantling of corruption, humiliation, and poverty. Finally, these subaltern resistance have different impacts depending on the echo they had or they made in the public sphere and the tactics the state used to contain them. For example, in the case of Amina Pileri, we can use the Habermasian distinction between the communicative and the administrative power to understand its impact. In the case of Pileri, there was strong public debates on the public sphere and social media, this is communicative power. The debate was also paralleled by demonstration in sit-ins in front of the Moroccan parliament in Rabat. Also because it's ideal that the Moroccan feminist movement adopted the case to put more pressure on the administrative parliament, the government, and the parliament to reform the penal code in general and the article in particular. In 2014, the communitative power was finally translated in the amendment of article 475. But still, I have another remark here. It states the response and the amendment of the article was done without hesitation because it was not costly in its political implications they mentioned. In other words, the amendment of the law does not have neither short nor long-term implications for the state political system and culture. In the case of Mercy Pickering,
I'm really sorry. I think it's very interesting, and perhaps we leave this to the discussion.
So I just finished by two sentences in conclusion. So despite all what he has said, despite the fact that these subaltern forms managed to reappropriate the public sphere, they have not, unfortunately, managed in leading any political, real political, economic, and social changes. The only thing we have is that we have more tolerance towards social and civil resistance forms nowadays, unlike in the past, and the emergence of this new culture, the political culture, we have a new emergence of a new political culture which gives a voice to the marginalized and makes the weak able to revolt against them and resist Haggar's humiliation and ask for change. I'm so sorry for being long. Thank you so much.
I'm sorry for being so rude, but the problem is that the time you are, of course, using beyond your, a lot of time can be deduced from your compensation. So this is a problem that, you know. Thank you for this interesting presentation, and thank you also for reminding us that we are still under, I would say, the rule of civil resistance. And this, of course, reminds us all of something you mentioned also, which is civil resistance during, you know, during colonialism, etc. And we're still living within this mindset. And we are saying we are modern, but I confirm what was said yesterday. I think modernity means first democratize the country, democratize our mindset, let change come like leaves to a tree, as John Keats said, the romantic poet. That is, we need to, I would say, instill democracy in the way we think, but we're still under the pressure of civil resistance in order to have those changes. And that's the real problem, I think, in our societies. So thank you for reminding us of these important aspects and how, of course, we're still within very old practices. That if we want change, let's first show acts of resistance. And I'm sure you see where I'm driving at. Thank you. The next speaker is Dr. Mumni from Sidi Mohammed Abdullah University in Fez, and he is going to talk to us about irregular migration and social change in Morocco. And I think the focus will fall on the concept of transition, I think, which is very important in nowadays, you know, geostrategic importance of Morocco. The concept of migration and how it is viewed by society, and also how these irregular migrants, he calls irregular migrants, and here, of course, I'm expecting him to show the nuance between illegal migration and irregular migration, because this is an important, I would say, difference, and how these impact, I would say, countries and impact social change in general. So the floor is yours, Dr. Mohammed. Thank you.
Beyond the Eurocentric approach that considers Morocco as a migrant-centered
past Morocco and since the mid-1990s, also evolved into a destination for migrants from sub-Saharan Africa, Europe, and elsewhere. In fact, the shift in the paradigm of movement from the north to the south is not as striking in the case of Moroccans abroad, but is still an important phase of migration that reflects a paradox in the Eurocentric approach that deals with transnational migration and mobility as a merely hegemonic and unified entity. Young unemployment, difficult economic conditions, along with social and political instability in different parts of the world, pushed people to migrate to Morocco, Italy, and Libya. Different migrants from sub-Saharan Africa moved Libya to Morocco to pursue their academic education or simply to work in different fields. Others moved illegally to Morocco to escape social and political oppression and considered Morocco as a transit country to move to other European countries. Global economic crisis in 2008 affected transnational migration and had more impact on Moroccan migrants living abroad in southern European countries and also on Europeans. Such financial crisis led to serious slowdown in job opportunities and affected migrants all over the world, causing short and long-term impacts and pushed many Europeans to move to Morocco to quest new job opportunities. European countries were also affected by the financial crisis and pushed many citizens, especially from the affected countries like Greece, Portugal, Spain, and France, to move to other developing countries like Brazil, India, or even Morocco. This phenomenon is witnessed both in the north and the south of Morocco, and where many Westerners from different European countries move to work and live. I will move our shift to the discussion and we will keep this item. So the year of 2011 is very important and can be considered as a turning point as many Arab societies revolted against authority and challenged the dominant systems aspiring for democracy, human dignity, and personal freedom. Such movements and transitory phases in the region pushed many South African migrants to move to Morocco. In addition, we find many Syrian refugees and other refugees. The huge waves of migrants from Europe, Africa, countries that witnessed the Arab Spring, put Morocco at stake and problematized the position of such migrants. Those migrants who used to use Morocco as a transit space realized that they would suffer from the consequences of a financial crisis and hence preferred to stay. Such attitudes towards European borders, along with the increase of migration flux, especially from Tunis, Libya, and Egypt in 2012, and the huge crisis of Syrian refugees in 2013, created a new phase of migration and reshuffled the tenacious face of Morocco as a site of settlement rather than a country of transit. In front of the world economic crisis, many migrants, especially from countries that witnessed the uprisings from sub-Saharan countries, decided to settle and live in Morocco. The presence of such migrants in the public sphere confronted Moroccan society with social and legal questions and puzzled the Moroccan state with different social, cultural, religious, and legal problems. The state's reaction towards such illegal migrants remained ambivalent and in many cases ignored their presence. However, such reaction could not last due to many reasons, the social mobility and the awareness of people, and also the way the people become aware of such issues, the image of Morocco abroad, along as many other reasons. All these reasons and others put pressures on Morocco regarding the issue of migration and also the dangerous journey that those migrants go through. Their journeys of suffering have its reliance on the inhuman condition and violent practices that migrants face. Such violence emanates from the migrants' hard living conditions, daily struggle and encounter with society, and also from the state's ignorance. Indeed, Moroccan states have a malicious eye on those illegal migrants and Arab Spring has brought considerable changes in the MENA region and created more challenges to Morocco by triggering two refugee crises in the neighborhood of Europe. In front of such actors, the Moroccan state had to make changes to rectify its energy board and to satisfy the needs of the European partners regarding such issues. Pressures from all sides emerged, and the restrictive security-based approach, largely emulating dominant European approaches and accompanying discourses, proved its failure. Such difficult situation pushed the Moroccan authorities to revisit migration laws and policies to avoid the harsh criticism that accuses Morocco of the abuse of human rights. In 2013, King Mohammed VI surprised the world community when he announced a new, more strongly Syrian-based migration policy. Its essential piece was a regularization program that granted legal status to nearly 18,000 irregular migrants, though Africans and Europeans, between 1st January and December 2014. Such migration policy helps Morocco not only to meet European concerns, but also to gain more power and strength in the African continent. Through such policy, Morocco can transit migrants in their stead through the process of regularization and induce them to change their decisions and hence settle in Morocco instead of any other European country. By doing so, Morocco respects the migration human rights and gains the support and the appreciation of many African countries as they serve Morocco and an ally in its confrontation in many other political issues. At the end of 2014, Morocco initiated an international strategy for services of migration. This strategy aimed at ensuring a better integration of the immigrants and a better management of the migration flux within the framework of a coherent, overall humanistic and responsible policy, which increased in a way the visibility of migrants in the public sphere and offered more space to protect themselves This strategy announced the integration of migrants regularized in 2014, as well as the elaboration of three laws of migration, asylum, and trafficking in 2013, and that helped migrants to articulate their problems to gain more power within society. The space of freedom granted to illegal migrants allowed them to shift their views about Morocco from being a transit space to one of an alternative settlement. Such change in Moroccan attitudes towards migration, along with its new geopolitical position, influences not only domestic policies, but also pushes towards a kind of social change as society becomes aware of such migrants' problems and pushes towards legal and human treatments of such issues. Indeed, the changes that occurred in the migration policy reflect a huge shift in the paradigms of economic and political interests. The condition of illegal migrants in Morocco is neither stable nor small. Many migrants face violent acts and even aggression at the hands of authorities and sometimes individuals. However, this reality of lack of protection in Morocco may mobilize illegal migrants to protect themselves through the sense of collaboration with other actors in Morocco and beyond, but also through their daily struggles with authorities. In 2005, illegal migrants strike across the Moroccan-Spanish borders. As a result, many migrants were killed. Such brutal incidents, known as CERTA and media scandal, created a starting point for migrants' mobilization and strive to create a kind of social awareness and also to gain visibility in the public sphere. The rise of different international organizations that deal with issues of sub-Saharan migrants in Morocco, along with the emergence of different councils and associations such as the Council of Sub-Saharan Migrants, established in 2005, the Collective of Sub-Saharan Migrants in Morocco, founded in 2010, and Al-Ittihad, founded in 2012, helped Sub-Saharan migrants to represent their different ethnic, religious, and cultural differences, as well as to all those institutions, along with activities managed by civil societies, succeeded at highlighting the problems and sufferings of sub-Saharan migrants. In Morocco, we put pressure on the Moroccan state to take the initiative to make a change by seeking challenges by including their situations in Morocco. The last event I'm going to talk about is the descent into the integration, the sense of integration, a social conflict that dates back to the 25th of November 2017, when violent clashes between sub-Saharan migrants and some Moroccans emerged. There are such cases were known as clashes emerged for that fuel when different sub-Saharan migrants refused to be removed from the gardens near the bus station and resisted both individuals and authorities, which led to re-confrontations that put the Moroccan authorities at stake while questioning the role of civil society associations and non-governmental organizations in Morocco. The refusal to leave the garden intensified the clashes and brutal, as many Moroccan members living in the Tiberian group was involved in such clashes. The inhabitants of the area that witnessed confrontations accused sub-Saharan migrants by trespassing the social and cultural norms and endangering their families' lives through their different manners of living and behaving within society put at stake the integration within the Moroccan social recovery. Such incidents of confrontation between the sub-Saharan migrants and Moroccans, between the sub-Saharan migrants themselves, is not new to our society, but remain isolated. The Moroccan society has been open to different ways of migrants throughout history, coexisted with migrants and tolerated their cultural and religious differences and incidents. Incidents like this reflect the complexity and the ambivalent nature of the issue of migration and its relationship with our societal changes and challenges. The relationship of sub-Saharan migrants with Moroccans remain relatively good despite the state's illegality and exclusion. Despite the ebb and flow that characterized such relationship lately, sub-Saharan migrants managed to articulate their voice thanks to the help of social activists, NGOs, and individual society. From society to simplify them in their lives. All that helped them to make a voice, their voice heard nationally and internationally and empower them. The process of legalization helped many undocumented migrants to legalize their stay in Morocco and to establish their business. Many migrants opened their shops and established their lives in a relatively welcoming society. Indeed, the openness of the Moroccan society, along with the changes that occurred in the Moroccan policies that deal with migration issues and transnational mobility, and the realities that took place in the public sphere created a kind of social change. And as people changed their views about sub-Saharan migrants, who are not only tolerated, but also potentially migrated. So, I'll conclude my paper by
resistance, I would perhaps extend it to papers like this one, like Dr. Mooney's paper, which I would perhaps include into the rubric of academic resistance, actually. And I think Dr. Mooney's paper, I think, analyzes, but mainly archives, the situation we are relapsing into because of this problem of migration, and mainly because of, I would say, inhuman and inhumane consequences and also decisions. Just, of course, go back to, of course, this notion of human trafficking and slavery nowadays because of this movement of this phenomenon, and also to inhuman decision of using razor fences, for example, in Ceuta and Melilla. So all these, of course, would prove that there is social change, but this social change has been imposed, I would say, by the Eurocentric approach to the issue. Dr. Mumi, I think, was smart enough to refer to so many of these aspects in analyzing this irregular migration. Our next speaker comes to us from University of Mumbai in India, Dr. Zeynep Berji, and her presentation will tackle another, I would say, important issue, which is modernity and museums. And to be frank, this is the first time I will listen to a presentation about Moroccan museums. And of course, in light of what has been said yesterday, I'm sure that we may have a lot of questions concerning art in general, and mainly museums, and to what extent can we say that our museums are modern, and I think that this is one of your main issues. Of course, trying to modernize and democratize our national museums, a very tantalizing question, I would say. Very interesting questions, actually, in your abstract. What does modernity signify in the current transformative mean in post-colonial Morocco? Is modernity in the Moroccan museums restricted to their display practices and multimedia technologies per se? And many other interesting questions. So I'll give you the floor to, of course, inform us on this subject. Thank you.
So ethnography collaborated Western modernity in Morocco, but differently. The ethnographic museums were spaces of the schools that visually and especially theorized the modern Occident and the traditional Orient that it held. The construction, basically, of the ethnographic museums was based on a colonial urban project of the modern city versus the traditional city. The ethnographic collections, or artifacts that the colonizers collected to represent traditional Morocco, were housed in Casbahs and the old houses in North Carolina. And the purpose was to frame a specific civilization in the past within the walls of the old city as a space of demarcation. This is a space where traditional history belongs. And also we can see the practice of Western civilization. The Casbahsan palaces, once centers of political and military power, they were transformed into public museums and spaces where the past was controlled, framed, and narrated. And here we think about the late 18th century and at the beginning of the 19th century, to the birth of museums in Western civilization, in Western Europe. And this idea of turning princely collections and royal palaces into public cultural institutions to represent the idea of progress, of research, of science, and of the people as well. So the collections were housed in Casbahs, and artifacts of the indigenous were viewed as exotic commodities to the Western gaze. The ethnographic collections were displayed within modern exhibitory conflicts within the modern exhibitory. Were not displayed within the modern exhibitory complex of the Occident. These policies strived to represent the local culture outside of the teleology of European history, and most particularly modernity. So, the case with archaeological museums was different because they were represented differently from the ethnographic collections. There were most of them constructed in the modern cities, and those collections that were housed in old palaces and Casbahs were represented within a modern complex of representation. So the collections that the colonizers excavated in many archaeological sites in Morocco were interpreted and displayed according to the modern display practices of the time. The purpose was to represent the idea of progress and scientific method as applied in Western museums. So the colonial museum project also placed much focus on excavating the artifacts that belonged to the Roman civilization because they saw themselves as inheritors or as a continuation of the Western Roman civilization in Morocco. So what happened in post-colonial Morocco? Did these museums change? And what happened to the concept of modernity within this specific historical phase? So the task of colonizing the national museums included minimal changes that occurred at the level of collections, themes, labels, narratives, and display practices. And very little attention was given to the cultural policies of the newly independent state for so many reasons. The cultural policy and the first years following independence had very little importance, otherwise the political competencies were confused. Also, due to the urgent priorities of the country, like education and its economic situation at the time, very little attention was given to cultural development. So, based on the systematic research that we conducted on the these museums, spaces of representation, labeling, the themes, the scenography, and also the mission statements of these museums, I can say that these very museums did not change that much. I mean, did not develop a very radical plan or theory concerning their very presence in Morocco as modern institutions. So the physical structures of Moroccan national museums were repositioned to serve as symbols of modernity, tactically used to converse with the West. And they functioned within or with a dualistic discourse on modernity, which placed the Moroccan society outside of the museum sphere. They played, like the times of colonialism, a role in representing modernity and progress. And these museums were basically empty monuments, and they were there just to represent the idea of modernity, to give an international image of a newly independent state that had these cultural and social institutions. So the museums were not yet seen as spaces of discourse in order to reconsider the concept of modernity and theorize, narrate, and negotiate history and national identity. So what happened in 2011 after the creation of the National Foundation of Museums? This organism came with new objectives out of the striving to modernize and democratize the national museums, and they have launched a considerable number of projects in this case. So we can here ask a very question that we asked in the beginning, which is the meaning of the concept of modernity in this transformative project. So the ethnographic museums, these are the findings of the study, always talking about the findings. The ethnographic museums that the French protectorate once established within a colonial realistic development project are always present. They do not have newly or purpose-built spaces or museums for the ethnographic and archaeological collections. So these locales have witnessed modernizing projects limited to the technologies and modes of display as embedded in the new museology. The buildings themselves have had a history of symbolism. They represented the indigenous in the old cities, a space of demarcation that signified the past and the traditional, and they were opposed to the modern city that represented modernity and progress. So this indicates that the current reform project has many shortcomings, and one of them is that the concept is modernity is yet overlooked, it is not well developed, and no relevant debates are initiated by authorities in the cultural domain. I can give you the example of the Archaeological Museum of Rabat, now known as the Museum of History and Civilizations. And based on a systematic study that I conducted in this museum, we can look at the findings in order to decide if we can see any radical changes concerning the theory and the statement of this museum. So the modernizing project focuses on a new scenography of representation that is to some extent not different from the previous one. Renovation in this museum is limited to modernization of multimedia technology and display practices as embedded in the new museology. So again, in this very museum, we can see the colonial museum practice, which is to focus on the Roman civilization, as demarcated by space, special division of object placement. We can still see this emphasis on the presence of the Romans in this museum. The Roman artifacts are the focal point in this space of representation. The museum does not include a radical reform project that is based on thorough historical reconsiderations and interpretations of the collections that the colonizers once collected and represented within new readings of history and relevant theories and concepts. This influences its functioning as an efficient platform for the creation and dissemination of scientific knowledge in the Moroccan society. So we can say as a general conclusion that the issue with the current transformative museum project is the lack of a comprehensive and historical perspective on the concept of modernity. So it is necessary to develop a genuine model of modernity that would contribute to the progress of this museum as a scientific, educational, and cultural institution that is inclusive and relevant to the present concerns of the Moroccan society. So in rethinking modernity, can we just forget about this cultural institution called the museum, because it was born in Western Europe? So can we just eliminate museums, the national museums in Morocco, and forget about anything related to them, like anthropology, archaeology, for instance? Can we just, like the case of the international insurgency crisis, and the destruction of everything related to culture and study studying past societies like archaeology, I don't think that concerning the complexity of the present societies and the world is a, as we say, is a global village, and the idea of intercultural influences, I don't think that eliminating the museum is a good idea. So, museums can be spaces where concepts are critically considered or reconsidered and not rejected based on their origin, since the refusal of the West does not itself constitute a culture. History and the past. So I'm talking about the a reform project where the museum itself can function as a mechanism in order to rethink both modernity and tradition. So history and the past are basically terms in museums. Once one needs to write and control history and memory in colonized societies, museums can now function as a mechanism to raise questions about mainstream history within a historiographic framework for reference in order to build local narratives. We can use museum as a soft power in culture and literacy. We can activate this soft power and take the museum as an activist itself. So museums are sites where the past, the present, and the future meet, and where the past can be revisited, questioned, reconsidered, and reshaped to understand the present. The museum is a medium and a form of expression regardless of the context that once shaped it. Such medium can function as a tool to question the very logocentric or eurocentric notions that once shaped them, and they can be new platforms or open platforms, democratic platforms, where these notions are redefined, liberated, negotiated beyond geography, history, and culture. Museums are spaces of discourse that can take the Khatibian position of double critique to look at the fantasy of the ideal past and pure identity, and to consider the complexity of the present world in which the myth of a pure fixed identity is irrelevant. Modernity in this context refers to a system of beliefs that are relevant to the present situation in Morocco as a post-colonial society. It is a new set of rules, moral, intellectual, political, technical, scientific, and aesthetic ideas and values that the Moroccan society would introduce to restructure itself through the institution of the museum, its relation to the past, to what is traditional, in order to examine the traditional values and update them in order to remodel them. So also this includes rethinking tradition itself. The thinking tradition is a necessary step towards a new identity. For those who should be viewed as a necessary task of developing a modern method and a modern vision of tradition, not as a fundamental rupture with tradition that is based upon a specific perception. This perception, as Algebra noted in his work, The Critique of Arab Reason, should be freed from that ideological and emotional charge that weighs on our conscience and forces us to perceive tradition as an absolute reality that transcends history, instead of perceiving it in its relativity and historicity. I have developed in this study a project, but I don't think I have enough time. I'm just going to give you an idea about what is practical in my study, because we can talk about the theoretical, but it's not enough. You always have this idea of how can you change these museums based on what you're seeing. This portfolio in order to talk about in order to present what is practical about this idea of modernizing the institution and both sides of the theory and practice. Talk about different civilizations that exist in Morocco. focus on the prehistoric Morocco, and we can take the example of the skull of Jebel Yehoud, if you know what I'm talking about, the discovery and defense of the oldest Homo sapiens skull in Morocco. And we can think about the questions that this skull, this specific skull, can raise in the National Moroccan Museum. I have been, I visited the Smithsonian Museums in Washington, D.C., and doing my research, I realized that it is a democratic space where we can discuss the evolutionist and the creationist theories about the presence of Homo sapiens in this world. And there is this possibility to create a democratic platform where we can discuss freely, and we can think about what is what comes within the evolutionist theory and what comes within the creationist theory. The case is different in Morocco because the archaeological museum does not represent or does not give enough theories or information or space to represent this specific skull, because this was, would raise so many questions about the history or about the theories within this specific museum. Evolutionist, creationist, I don't think that the idea of evolution can be much developed in the National Museums based on certain other considerations, but we would like to have a democratic space where we can discuss theories freely and where people can have the right to think based on their own beliefs. I can believe in evolution, I can believe in creation, and I think that museums could provide this opportunity for me, this platform where I can discuss based on my own beliefs. So thank you so much, and I hope that this was clear.
Thank you, Dr. Deji, for this very informative presentation, and I think we feel the novelty actually in the presentation, first because it deals with museums, which most of us of course we take as places where we can remember history, remember our ancestors, etc. But I think that relating this to modernization and to democratization, I think remains within a novel approach to museums, especially in a culture like the Moroccan, of course. And we know how complex, of course, our culture is. And that's why I do agree with you that we need to rethink tradition, we need to rethink culture, you know. And a museum, as you rightly expressed it, perhaps the modern, I would say, aspect in this field would be to, can we, or I would perhaps phrase it in the form of a question, can we really freely discuss the creationist versus the evolutionist, you know, theories? This remains a big question, because I come to your first idea that museums is a legacy of the West, actually, the space, again, the space is or should be, I would say, under modern perspectives. Sometimes, and you reminded us also that some of us take modernity as just emulating the West. Emulating the West, of course, yes, in establishing these institutions, but we should also think of modernity in the practices we have in these institutions, and very, I would say, tantalizing presentation, I would say. Thank you very much, Dr. Deji. The last but not least, this is the traditional cliche phrase, last but not least, we'll listen to Dr. Hadid Suheila, who is coming to us from Santrina. You're welcome, and to say that the presentation is a field work, and this is again another aspect which I think is interesting. Field work concerning a comparative approach concerning a sociolinguistic, you know, I would say question, which is that of, you know, les discours que les jeunes maghrébins entretiennent et aussi ce que pensent les uns des parlés des autres. Donc c'est une approche très intéressante et peut-être ça va nous mener à une discussion peut-être très intéressante aussi. Merci beaucoup, Dr. Hedid. La parole est à vous.
Alors, moi, je vous montre pourquoi avec moi vous allez assister à une communication en français. Je dis bien malheureusement pour vous parce que tout le monde ici parle anglais. Donc, je suis désolée, je ne parle pas anglais, je parle français. Alors, en fait, l'étude que je vais vous présenter aujourd'hui, c'est vraiment les tout premiers résultats que j'ai obtenus suite à une enquête. Très grande enquête qui a visé trois pays du Maghreb. Et c'est une enquête que je mène depuis deux ans et demi maintenant avec la jeunesse maghrébine, des jeunes tunisiens, algériens et marocains. Comme partenaire, j'ai des collègues sociolinguistes comme moi, tunisiens, algériens aussi et marocains. Et notre principe de base est d'interroger tout d'abord les pratiques langagières, c'est-à-dire comment ces jeunes parlent, pour arriver à leur représentation, à leur imaginaire linguistique. Les premières données qu'on a collectées déjà, qui ont ciblé les pratiques langagières, ont déjà fait objet de plusieurs communications et publications. La partie que je vais vous présenter aujourd'hui touche uniquement à leur imaginaire linguistique, à leur représentation, à toutes les images qu'ils ont sur les parlés des autres. Alors, l'étude au début, le premier titre que j'ai envoyé à M. Nachid était tout simplement « Les jeunes maghrébins, ce que pensent les uns et parler des autres ». Mais après, pour faciliter la tâche, pour que le titre soit plus facile à comprendre pour les étudiants et tout, surtout après avoir vu la première version du programme, je me suis dit « Mais j'ai affaire à des gens peut-être qui ne sont pas tout à fait dans ma spécialité ». Donc j'ai essayé de mettre ce titre-là et qui me semble encore plus facile et plus facile à comprendre. Voilà. Alors, dans l'imaginaire linguistique des jeunes maghrébins, l'objectif de l'étude, on va essayer de mettre l'accent sur la dimension épilinguistique des parlés des jeunes maghrébins. Ce que je vous dis épilinguistique, ça touche tout simplement l'imaginaire linguistique des images qu'on a sur des langues. Ce qu'on va faire particulièrement, c'est qu'on va essayer d'interroger ces images, les représentations, on va essayer de pénétrer l'imaginaire linguistique de ces jeunes sur les parlés qu'ils étudient. Et ce, dans les trois pays du Maghreb. Le contexte d'étude, alors, ce qui marque un tout petit peu notre différence par rapport aux études qu'on a l'habitude de faire, c'est qu'habituellement, voilà ce que j'ai mentionné, les corpus collectés présentent ces pratiques en rapport direct avec leur contexte d'apparition. Ce sont des études généralement contextualisées qui partent d'une situation de communication bien particulière, c'est-à-dire les Algériens travaillent sur l'Algérie, les Tunisiens travaillent sur l'Algérie, les Français sur la France, les Américains sur l'Amérique, et ainsi de suite. Alors, dans notre cas, nous allons nous pencher sur ces parlers d'un autre point de vue. Nous allons essayer d'interroger l'imaginaire linguistique de ces jeunes afin d'étudier les discours que les uns tiennent sur les parlers des autres. C'est-à-dire, quelle est l'image. Alors, pour être plus... la méthodologie, comment on va travailler, on travaille toujours avec des enquêtes de terrain, avec des questionnaires, des observations directes et indirectes, avec des prises de notes, avec certainement, et particulièrement, une vision anthropologique pour l'utilisation des images qui nous vient de la tradition américaine d'anthropologie visuelle. Dans l'objectif toujours d'interroger les représentations des jeunes maghrébins, la problématique, elle est clairement énoncée sur la présentation que vous avez en face de vous, alors je me permets de lire mon travail. Ce que pensent les uns des parlés des autres, ce que pensent les Tunisiens des parlés des autres jeunes maghrébins, comment les jeunes algériens se représentent-ils des pratiques langagières de leurs voisins, quelle image ont les jeunes marocains des variétés linguistiques pratiquées par les autres locuteurs jeunes de leur génération. Alors, le corpus sur lequel on a travaillé pour 25 ans, filles et garçons des deux sexes étaient intégrés dans l'étude. Vous avez des calculs en face de vous, le nombre de participants dans chaque pays. Alors, les outils d'investigation, là, les résultats que je vais vous présenter aujourd'hui sont tirés uniquement des questionnaires. Donc, si j'avais utilisé les images et tout, ça va être une communication de 10 heures au plus, donc pour limiter la communication. Et là, je me réfère à Louis Jean Capet, c'est un très bon sociolinguiste qui travaille bien sûr en français, et qui nous explique qu'il n'y a pas mieux que le questionnaire lorsque vous désirez, lorsque vous cherchez à interroger les discours épilinguistiques. Alors, le questionnaire que nous avons élaboré pour cette étude se compose de quatre parties. Identification des informateurs, répertoire verbal, justement pour définir un tout petit peu l'univers linguistique dans lequel ils ont été élevés. Les pratiques langagières pour voir un tout petit peu la dimension langagière, les pratiques des langues qu'ils utilisent entre eux et dans l'environnement dans lequel ils vivent, pour arriver finalement aux représentations sociolinguistiques. Vous allez me dire, mais pourquoi toutes ces données-là, pourquoi ne pas attaquer les représentations directement? Parce que ce n'est pas fiable. Pour arriver aux représentations, pour avoir des données fiables sur les représentations, il faut passer tout d'abord par les pratiques. C'est à partir de mes pratiques langagières que je vais juger vos pratiques langagières. C'est à partir de vos pratiques langagières de jeunes Marocains et tout, vous allez me dire, mais vous n'êtes pas Marocain, vous ne parlez pas Marocain, et ainsi de suite. Et c'est à partir de là, c'est votre base. C'est à partir de là que vous allez construire tout un discours épilinguistique sur mes pratiques langagières en tant que Constantinoise algérienne. Alors, le protocole dans lequel, en Algérie, c'était des entretiens directs, bien sûr, j'étais sur place, les informateurs étaient sur place, donc c'était facile pour moi. Pour la Tunisie et le Maroc, j'ai contacté par téléphone et par mail, j'ai envoyé le questionnaire par mail à mes collègues tunisiens et marocains, qui ont transféré les questionnaires aux jeunes de leur pays. Les consignes, les explications et tout ont été communiqué par mail et par téléphone aussi, c'était plus pratique. Alors, la lecture des données collectées à partir des questionnaires, j'ai essayé de croiser les questions avec des réponses, et quatre étapes ont fait leur apparition. Donc, les données que vous allez voir après sont classées selon ces termes: les dialectes du Maghreb, les parler des gens maghrébins, le contact des langues chez les gens maghrébins, leur parler et ceux des autres. Alors, pour le premier thème, les dialectes du Maghreb, que pensez-vous des dialectes utilisés par les maghrébins? Pensez-vous que les dialectes pratiqués dans les pays se ressemblent? Pourquoi? Alors, je vous laisse lire les tableaux et en même temps, je vais vous donner quelques explications concernant votre analyse sociolinguiste. Alors, j'attire votre attention à une chose, il y a des anomalies, il y a des erreurs sur les tableaux, mais c'est pas moi, ce sont j'ai fait du copier-coller à partir des questionnaires. Vous savez très bien qu'on n'a pas le droit de toucher au questionnaire. Donc, si vous allez remarquer des anomalies, ce n'est pas moi, ce sont les informateurs. Alors, le premier cadrage des représentations montre qu'il y a un partage, que ces gens-là partagent un fond imaginaire commun. Aussi impressionnant soit-il, les référents utilisés sont similaires, que les jeunes soient pour ou contre, ils recourent à des facteurs identiques tels que l'histoire, la géographie, la politique. Et l'étude comparative de ces résultats laisse apparaître une mise en avant des similitudes entre les dialectes. Certains vont jusqu'à établir des descriptifs plus précis en faisant des répartitions et des correspondances pour mieux clarifier dans leurs réponses. Alors, les Algériens de l'Est comprennent très bien les Tunisiens, les Algériens de l'Ouest comprennent très bien les Marocains. Les Marocains vous disent tout simplement qu'on comprend parfaitement les Oranais, les Algériens, mais on ne comprend pas les gens de l'Est algérien. Les Tunisiens, la même chose, et partagent l'Algérie en deux. Les Algériens pensent que les Tunisiens ont parlé un peu chantant-gois. Les Marocains, non, ça me rappelle l'oral. Et ainsi de suite. Alors, concernant le deuxième thème, les parler des gens maghrébins, comment qualifiez-vous les langues utilisées par les jeunes de ces pays? N'évoquez pas le cas de votre pays, parlez des autres, c'est pour les pousser à parler, pour faire une distinction entre leur propre parler et le parler algérien et le parler tunisien. les gens maghrébins sont considérés comme bilingues et même plurilingues, c'est-à-dire qu'ils parlent plusieurs langues. Qu'en pensez-vous? Alors la définition que je voulais mentionner entre parenthèses, c'était parce qu'on arrive à faire à des étudiants en médecine, biologie, des autres spécialités, et le terme bilingue pluriel ne signifie pas grand-chose chez eux. C'est pour ça qu'on a essayé de définir un tout petit peu le truc. Alors je vous laisse lire les données. Alors l'alternance codique marque toutes les réponses. Les codes les plus évoqués sont l'arabe et le français, et parfois l'anglais. Certains jeunes critiquent cette pratique car elle nuit à la pertinence des échanges et affaiblit les langues. D'autres évoquent le niveau des jeunes et ils estiment ainsi que ces jeunes maghrébins mélangent beaucoup de langues car ils n'ont aucune maîtrise d'aucune langue et qu'ils font ça justement pour camoufler leurs lacunes. Mais en fait, la variation constatée renvoyait au fait que ces nouvelles pratiques reflètent une vision du monde différente de celle de leurs parents, de l'ancienne génération. Et le recours permanent aux réseaux sociaux fait que ces pratiques et ces codes deviennent des codes à déchiffrer et à décoder. Alors, concernant le troisième état, le contact des langues chez les jeunes maghrébins, pensez-vous que les étudiants de français et les autres langues, parce qu'ils les maîtrisent, sinon, pourquoi ils ont mélangé ces langues lorsqu'ils parlent? Justifiez votre réponse. Alors, là, il y a ce tableau, c'est écrit tout petit, je suis désolée, mais apparemment, c'est visible. Alors, là, il y a plusieurs états, mais les références, il y a plusieurs référents, mais ce qui est impressionnant, je le redis encore une fois, c'est que les mêmes références sont utilisées. Alors, la mondialisation, la colonisation, la langue, et le français est une langue du prestige, l'habitude, l'influence de l'Internet, des réseaux sociaux particulièrement, la maîtrise et comme dernier élément, c'est pour camoufler nos lacunes. Leur parler et ceux des autres, estimez-vous que les langues des jeunes maghrébins sont mieux conçues que la vôtre? Pourquoi? Justifiez votre réponse. Comment qualifiez-vous les langues des jeunes maghrébins par rapport à celles des autres jeunes dans le monde? Justifiez votre réponse. Alors, là, comme vous voyez sur l'affichage, un fort sentiment de tolérance est affiché. Les jeunes évitent de donner leur avis ouvertement. Cependant, et pour répondre à la deuxième question, ils n'hésitent pas à dépasser cet esprit de tolérance pour nous livrer des données extrêmement intéressantes à étudier. Les jeunes font des comparaisons qui les placent au-dessus de toute la jeunesse du monde, dans des rangs encore plus supérieurs aux autres, et c'est particulièrement les Français et les Américains. Les Français qui qualifient comme monolingues et n'ont pas cette richesse linguistique chez eux, ils ne sont pas comme nous, et n'ont plus le français et un peu d'anglais, nous les maghrébins. On a l'arabe avec plusieurs langues, on a le français et on a l'anglais, on maîtrise très très bien l'anglais, et critique notamment la jeunesse américaine qui ne parle aucune autre langue à part l'anglais. Alors, la lecture des données récoltées permet de tracer un descriptif assez précis des différentes configurations et reconfigurations épilinguistiques qui définissent la sous-structure des représentations. Il nous semble évident que les langues jouent toujours un rôle primordial dans l'imaginaire des jeunes. Les codes linguistiques attribuent des statuts, rendent plus quantifiable la valeur d'une communauté linguistique, accentuent les différences entre les uns et les autres. Ces faits pèsent toujours sur l'imaginaire des locuteurs, les poussent à créer des images et des dialectes, et à juger, à qualifier des dialectes des uns et des autres. Trois éléments sont à mentionner dans cette présentation-là et qui ont vraiment marqué les données collectées, à savoir la similitude dans les référents données utilisées par cette jeunesse. Ce maghreb plurilingue d'aujourd'hui, un maghreb pour une valorisation des langues étrangères et surtout le français. Merci pour votre attention.
Merci, docteur Judith. Comme dirait le langage, je ne dis rien. Le code switching est un problème de. Well, I mean, it's the long, you know, la lingua franca, l'hybridité, bien sûr, et l'utilisation de smartphone, et tout ça. Donc, c'est tout un monde causé par la modernité, bien sûr, mais dont on subit les conséquences. Merci, Dr. David.
And, merci,
I'd like to thank the speakers for keeping within the deadline and I would say the time limit.